So this is the theorem we wanted to prove last time, right? So the idea is pretty simple. This is, let's say, suppose this is the point Z naught, and we create an annulus which should entirely lie, enter origin 0. The annulus must lie entirely inside Z naught, otherwise it will not make any sense to have, because F may not even be defined there. So let's pick up an annulus, which is this one. Okay. So this is the domain D, and this annulus that I am picking up. Oh. This is centered at Z naught inside D, and this I will cut by making a single slice here, so that it becomes a single curve, the boundary of this annulus, and I traverse this boundary counterclockwise, starting from outside, going here, then coming here, then going down here. So this is clockwise, then going back on this, and then continuing counterclockwise, completing this circuit. And we use the standard trick that at this point, instead of running over the same cut twice, you just separate them by a very tiny amount, so that it's this traversal is very well defined everywhere. And let's call this region. So that is the region which is encompassed by this curve R. Okay. Now, F is completely analytic inside this region. Forget about completely. F is analytic inside this region. Therefore, by Cauchy integral formula, if there is a point, let's say any point Z here, I can write F of Z as the integration along the boundary of R of F w divided by w minus z d w. Okay. Now let's look at the boundary. Boundary is this, 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 and this. Now as this two parts tend towards each other, their integral around those parts will cancel each other out. So what we will be left with in the limit is integral counterclockwise on this and integral clockwise on this inside circle. So let's say this, these are both circles centered at Z naught. Let's say this is beta, this distance, and this distance is alpha. So then I can rewrite this as Now, the first part is familiar. Here the integral is on W's, which are on the outside circle, and Z is inside. That is, Z is closer to Z naught than these W's are. So let's just rewrite this a bit, because I want everything in terms of or expand around Z naught. Now, W minus Z naught as W moves around this circle is larger in absolute value than Z minus Z naught. So, this is standard or familiar thing that we did for power series also. So, therefore, I can rewrite this as in this integral, W is running over the inside circle. So, absolute value of W minus Z naught is smaller than Z minus Z naught. So, I can expand this, but taking out Z minus Z naught and then doing it. Now, we can use the uniform convergence of this power series in the region of interest to swap the integral with summation, and we get summation k greater than or equal to 0 integral of I forgot 1 over 2 pi I here. So, there is 1 over 2 pi I everywhere. And if you just change this summation or by replacing the index k with minus 1 minus k. So, just redefine k to be minus 1 minus k. So, this becomes k, this becomes k plus 1. Then you get okay. There is a bit of a problem here because these two integrals are over different circles. So I cannot write it exactly like this. So let me still go with a split definition. So, we are almost there. Well, actually, we are there because now this is a Lorentz series. We also have the value of the coefficients of the Lorentz series, that it is for the on the positive side, it is these integrals, on the negative side, it is these integrals. So, that completes the proof of the theorem, but actually, we can do one step better and make these two integrals over the same circle. Do you see the reason? In fact, let me state it this way. Let me just write it as equal to sum k going to minus infinity to infinity 1 over 2 pi I integral I can replace this integral over circles of radius alpha or beta by a circle of radius r, as long as that circle lies inside the analysis, not inside the region, the domain D. Why? Exactly. So, this function that you are integrating f w over w minus z naught to the k plus 1 is analytic inside that analysis. Because f is analytic, this is analytic. Why is this analytic? Because it never vanishes and it is inverse of an analytic function. W minus z naught absolute value is always non-zero. So, this is so the product of two analytic function analytic. So, this is analytic, and since it is analytic inside that analysis, its integral over any circle inside that analysis is going to be the same. That is by Cauchy. And so, we have a uniform definition of the constants of this expansion. circular around it, not, yes.
Doesn't it require that pumps also be defined on that point?
Yes, so it's defined. So it's, we are only in, see, we are, if you integrate around this circle, on this circle the function is well defined. And inside this, this and this, this analysis, look at this analysis. Inside this analysis, function is analytic. The complete, not at fw, but fw divided by w minus z naught to the k plus 1 is analytic, right. So, if you cut, make a cut here and look at that region, the integral around the boundary of this by Cauchy, the integral is 0 and therefore, the two integrals are the same. Of course, the same thing does not apply here because w minus z naught can become 0 in this integral. Not this, not in this integral, but inside the region, inside this disk where we are doing the integral, it can become 0, or here inside this region, the delta r, it can become 0. So, you cannot, this is not 0, this is non-zero. Okay. So, that is the Lorentz series expansion of an analytic function around a singularity. And it expansion makes sense only around a singularity, because if the point z naught is not a singularity, then its expansion is simply a power series. And this expansion is defined on the annulus which lies inside the domain, and this, the inner circle we should, we can shrink to as small as possible, and outer circle we can expand to as large as possible. That does not matter. So, that will remain the same. So, this gives us a more general way of expressing an analytic function, especially it allows us to study the singularities in a much nicer way. The power series always avoided singularities, whereas this actually uses a singularity to expand the function around it. So, we can study the behavior of an analytic function around a singularity using a Lorentz series. We cannot do that using power series. And that is something that is going to be very, very important for us, because singularities of an analytic function are going to play a very important role. In fact, you already see this is an analytic function with one singularity at w equals z, and you already note that it has a very interesting role to play, that it actually gives me a value of f at z. So, we will see as we move along more and more usages of analytic function around a singularity. But first, let us address the singularity themselves a bit. So, we saw zeros of an analytic function, right. The most important thing about them was that zeros are isolated, and every zero has an associated order with it, right. That is the order of the first few terms, that first term, number of terms that are zero in power series expansion, that is the order of the zero. Can we say same thing about singularities? Can we say that singularities of an analytic function are isolated? Make a guess. Answer is very simple. Inverse? You mean to say they are isolated? That's that's what you have to answer. Yes. They are actually not. Huh?
What do you exactly mean when you say analytic?
Okay, so analytic function, of course, there is a domain associated where it is analytic. The rest of it. So, presumably there are. It's. It may or may not be defined. See, it's possible that the analytic function can be continued more in a larger domain. So, whatever it can be continued more and more and more, whatever maximum possible continuation is there. After that, what is left is places where it cannot be analytically continued, which means that these are singularities. So, are those singularities isolated? Well, okay, let's take an example, the analytic function. This is analytic inside unit disk. What about its singularities? They are everywhere. After that, there is completely singular behavior. There is nothing outside there. So, this immediately shows that singularities of an analytic function need not be isolated. Now, when the singularities are not isolated, those are not very interesting cases for us, because that is a complete mess. We are typically not even going to be interested in those regions. So, we will only be interested in those singularities which are isolated, because those are the interesting singularities of analytic. So, from henceforth, we will restrict our attention to isolated singularities. You understand what an isolated singularity is, right? A singularity such that a small enough neighborhood around it has no other singularity. Fine. Now, isolated singularities also have a very nice property that we can write a nice Lorentz series expansion of the function around that singularity in a small region. And the analysis is just the punctured disk, because there is only one singularity which is right now sitting there. So, you just puncture that, and that analysis is the Lorentz series expansion of the function, which means that we can study the behavior of through that Lorentz series, we can study the behavior of the analytic function around that singularity completely. We know the exactly how its value behaves around that singularity. Okay. So, we can, let me just write it down, it's because it is important. Okay, we can, yeah, write and we'll use this observation to study the behavior of the not only analytic function, but also because we can study it around the singularity, we'll be able to say something about that singularity itself. So let F be analytic on D with isolated singularity at Z naught. Now, using the previous observation, let us write F as some disk punctured at Z naught of radius r. Okay. Now, when I say inside, you take it to mean that it is punctured at Z naught. So, what can we say about the singularities here? Well, it turns out there are going to be three types of singularities, which I am going to describe now. And these singularities are characterized by behavior of F around Z naught. Type 1 is called removable singularity. This is actually not a singularity, this is a phony singularity. This occurs when in the Lorentz series expansion, all the negative coefficients are 0. So, actually Lorentz series is a power series. So, actually there is no singularity there. So, then why do we even call it a singularity? Well, technically a singularity is defined if the function appears to be undefined there. So, to take a most silly example of this, if you look at the function z square by z at z equals 0, if you are treat it completely dumbly, z square goes to 0 and z goes to 0, so it is 0 by 0, therefore undefined. There are not so silly examples also. I mean, there are, for example, sin z by z, that is also 0 by 0, but of course, we all know that we can remove it. But why do we know that we can remove it? Only through this, actually, even this an argument that this is not really a singularity at z equals 0 is by make the Lorentz series expansion of this and show that all these are 0, all the negative coefficients are 0, and therefore it is non-singular, it is removable. So, this is just a formalization of this whole thing. Okay, clear? There is a nice character, and I said that these are characterized by behavior of F around Z naught. So, how are these removable singularities characterized as? So f has a removable singularity at naught if and only if fz is bounded around z naught. And when I say around z naught, is taken to mean a small enough disk around z naught. And the proof is fairly straightforward. Let's tackle this. Let's get the proof out of you guys. Which way do we start? Suppose f has a removable singularity, okay? Then how do we prove that f is bounded around z naught? So let's assume less than equal to epsilon z minus z naught the absolute value. That's a very tiny disk. You need to show that absolute value of z is bounded. And that's pretty straightforward. Use the definition f is this Lorentz series expansion. All the negative ak's are 0, so only the positive ak's survive. So a 0 will be a 0, and the other ones, a 1 will be multiplied with an absolute value. If you look at the absolute value of this, epsilon, epsilon square, epsilon cube, the higher coefficient, and since epsilon is tiny, it's all converges to some finite value. This is less than equal to sigma k greater than equal to 0 a k epsilon to the k. Okay. And this therefore converges to something. Well, of course, here one is assuming that f is analytic on D. So, there is a non-trivial annulus on which this is convergent. If it is not convergent anywhere, then of course there is no point talking here of anything at all. But if it is convergent inside an annulus, which is this, its epsilon is much smaller than r, so it is certainly convergent, and it converges to some finite value. And therefore, this is bounded by some value inside. The converse, if f is bounded around z naught, what? Yeah, that's another way. Instead of using this, use the contrapositive. If f does not have a removable singularity, then that's not going to work directly. Because what might happen is that infinitely many of ak's are non-zero, negative ak's are non-zero. And then somehow those sums converge to something. Well, one can argue that they don't, but you need to mess around with infinite sums. One would like a more direct and simpler proof here, which fortunately exists. You get a definition of ak, exactly. You want to show that ak's are 0 for all k less than 0. What is the definition of ak? Ak we saw was 1 over 2 pi I integral of w minus z naught equals an r, which is can be any circle as long as it is within this. So, I can choose it to be epsilon as long as epsilon non 0, f w divide by w minus z naught to the k plus 1 d w. So, if you look at the absolute value of this, this is going to be less than equal to, just forget about constants, this is bounded f w. So, there is some c, constant c, so that absolute value of f w is bounded by c. This is in absolute value epsilon to the k plus 1, right. So, this is, and this as you integrate, once you take this out and integrate, you get 2 pi epsilon, right. So, basically what you will get is a k, you will get to be order 1 over epsilon to the k. Epsilon to the k plus 1 here, 2 pi epsilon comes after integration, the 1 epsilon cancels out, forget about 2 pi's, they are all constants, and this is also a constant. So, all gets absorbed in this. Now, as you send epsilon to 0, what happens? For negative case, they all go to 0. Neglecting z 0, of course, yes, because z 0 is singularity, so we do not know what is happening, but that is good enough, because we do not actually have to take this, go to epsilon equal to 0. We are showing that a k cannot have a non-zero value, because we can make choose a small l of epsilon to make it smaller than that. So, that is pretty straightforward. So, these are sort of silly singularities, as I said, they do not even exist. What is more interesting is, and actually the most interesting kind of singularities are type 2. These are called poles. A k is not equal to 0 for when a k is non-zero for a finitely many k less than 0, and that has to be non-zero value. So, the examples of this one by z is the simplest possible example here, a minus 1 is non-zero. So, what with as with zeros, we have an associated order with a pole. So, it is equal to the largest value of n such that a of minus n is non-zero. So, this is almost dual of the order of a 0. And how is a pole defined by the behavior of f around z naught? it has a pole around Z naught if and only if as you send Z goes to Z naught, the absolute value of Z goes to infinity. Now, this is a bit of a loaded statement, because when I say Z goes to Z naught, I can take Z to Z naught along any path. So that's very important, not only one path. So it doesn't matter which path I take it to Z naught, FZ always diverges. And the proof of this is again fairly straightforward. If F has a pole at Z naught, then just pulling out the definition, F has a Lorentz series expansion with, let's say, a pole of order n. So which means that there is, if F has a pole Z naught, then I write F Z as a minus n by n plus higher degree terms. And now if you see that if you send Z naught Z to Z naught, all of these, in particular this, diverges. These will also diverge, but the rate of divergence here will be faster than here. You can make this argument more precise by considering, okay, if you let, because sometimes these arguments are subtle, so one has to be very careful when making these arguments. So just to emphasize that, I define g z to be z minus z naught to the n times f z. Now g, what is g of z naught? Less than 0, right? So then I can write f z as g of z by z minus z naught to the n. Now you see that clearly, as z goes to z naught, this is non-zero and this goes to 0. So clearly diverges. It does not matter what path I take. And conversely, if you assume that F z diverges around z naught everywhere, I mean it just tends towards infinity, then how do I show that F has a pole at z naught? This is a little trickier, not straightforward. Pretty simple. So again, define g slightly differently to be 1 over f z. Okay. Then what can we say about g z? G is analytic. Around z naught, because f z does not take value 0 around z naught, and is bounded. Why is it bounded? Because absolute value of f z around z naught is very large. So therefore, g z is bounded around z naught. So it is analytic and bounded around z naught. Of course, g z naught, I am saying it's not clear what is definition. I'm not even defining it right now. But the fact that it is bounded and analytic around z naught means that I can invoke the type, this is a type, if at all it has a singularity at z naught, is a type 1 singularity, which means it's removable. And if it has a removable singularity at Z naught, it means its G Z naught can be defined in a unique way. And how is it defined in a unique way? Well, just take one path and send this, this is going to diverge, so G of Z naught has to be 0. Okay. Now, G is an analytic function in this disk. It vanishes at Z naught, so it has a 0 at Z naught. Now, every 0 is isolated, of course, we know. And there is an order associated with this. So, let G have a 0 of order n at Z naught. Then we can write g z as z minus z naught to the n times h z. With h z naught not 0, that is by definition of the order of 0. And now I can write f z as 1 over Now, here h z is analytic around z naught, it is not 0 around z naught. So, 1 over h z is also analytic around z naught, and oops, there is an n here. And this shows that f has a pole of order n. Because 1 over h z I can write as a power series around z naught, and which does not vanish at z naught. So, this is going to be a Lorentz series with a minus n being the largest or smallest non-zero coefficient. Okay. Why is G bounded? Because of this. In a small disk, because of this property, if you have z naught and you look at a small disk here, look at this region. As this size shrinks, absolute value of z goes to infinity. So, at some point, let us say absolute value of z exceeds 10 everywhere. It will be, because no matter where you approach from any point, no matter how you approach z naught, you are going to diverge. So, means for every point around this, in a small enough disk, the absolute value of z is say at least 10. And if absolute value of z is at least 10 on that disk, g z is at most 1 by 10 in the absolute value. So, it is bounded. Mm-hmm. Okay. This. No, at what z naught? Z naught equals 0. So you're saying summation k greater than equal to 0, 1 over z to the k. Okay. This is a Lorentz, infinite Lorentz series, yes. And as z goes to z naught, does absolute value go to infinity? Does it? That's type 3 singularity. These are called essential singularities. When AKs are non-zero for infinitely many k less than 0 of this kind. The example is as just now you gave. Or e to the 1 by z square, e to the 1 by z. What I want to write is that there is a sequence of points u m tending towards z naught. Okay. So each of this point is closer and closer to z naught. That's what I mean here. So I'm not writing it very precisely. Essential singularities exhibit completely bizarre behavior. They diverge, they don't diverge. As you go from z to z naught, depending on what path you follow, you can get any result that you want. We'll prove it in the next class, but just to convince you of this, let's look at this. If you approach it from the positive real axis, what happens? Approach towards 0 from the positive real axis, goes to infinity. Approach towards 0 from the positive imaginary axis. Minus infinity, positive imaginary axis. So, z is I y. So, you get e to the 1 over I y, y tending towards 0. What is the absolute value of this? E to the 1 over I y, what is the absolute value of this? It is always 1, does not matter what y is. So, if you approach it from the positive imaginary axis towards 0, the absolute value stays at 1. And this is not the only end of the story, as this theorem says, you can get any value that you desire as the limit depending on what path you choose to approach it. What? Same story, absolutely same story. This is true for every essential singularity. An essential singularity is defined as infinitely many AKs being non-zero, which is the case here. Okay, so we'll continue this in the next class.